Good evening, everybody. Thanks for joining us on Facebook tonight. I am joined by Carlos Morales, who's the owner of Viva Technology. We really appreciate your time tonight.
Thank you.
You are a parent as well as an expert on technology.
Yes.
Your littles are probably a little bit too little to be worrying about some of this stuff, right? 6 and 9?
6 and 9, yes.
Okay. Now, we know that kids younger and younger are getting familiar with technology, but really, I think the age group we're talking about tonight is more junior high, mm-hmm. high school. And trying to give us as parents, I have a 13-year-old and a 15-year-old, just trying to give us as parents an insight into their world, because mm-hmm. it really does feel like a foreign world to us as parents mm-hmm. these days, even if we're pretty tech savvy.
Yeah.
And I thought you said something really interesting before we went live on Facebook, which was, we talk a lot about all these secretive things that are happening online, but then we kind of leave parents sometimes with the feeling of, okay, well, so now what?
Mm-hmm.
What do we do about it?
Right.
We make it into this very scary place that they're living.
Yeah, I mean, for the most part, you know, every time we have this type of conversation, we talk about the negative aspect of using technology mm-hmm. or social media or having a cell phone or downloaded apps. And yeah, there's some negative aspects of it, but there's some positive ones as well. But, you know, and it's so hard for a parent to actually try to keep up with all this information. But at the end of the conversation, we just leave them hanging. It's like, okay, so what do we do? Mm-hmm. I mean, you just told me all the things that I need to be worrying about, but you have not given me any options. Mm-hmm. How can I monitor? How can I actually control? How can I get more involved in having a conversation with my kids about the proper use of technology? And so hopefully that's what we'll do tonight as we carry on this conversation. And I will be able to give you some apps that actually parents can download and they can use and very effectively in a way that they can monitor their kids and they can control how they use technology as well.
All right, and we want to invite you, please, post your questions. This is a conversation that all of us get to have with Carlos tonight. This is right in my wheelhouse as I'm raising teenagers. And our topic tonight at 10 on our If My Parents Only Knew series mm-hmm. is specifically cheating mm-hmm. and technology. Mm-hmm. And I was doing a little bit of research ahead of time and found a survey that said 75% of parents think that kids are using their cell phones to cheat, but only 3% think their child is using the cell phone to cheat.
Yes.
Do you think parents are naive about how these cell phones are being used in school?
I think here's what happened. I mean, when we talk about cheating, now that we actually have access to technology, for the most part, we're not thinking that our kids are going to be using their cell phones or they're going to be using their tablets or going to be using their iWatch to sort of actually look information in regards to the tests that they're taking. And so, you know, it's hard for parents to think in that way. We usually, when we talk about cheating, we talk about passing notes or sort of actually, you know, mm-hmm. Glancing over or trying to talk to a friend. But now, with the use of technology, it's so easy to do. Mm-hmm. It's very easy to cheat. It's very easy to send a text message asking the question, not necessarily to someone who is in there with you,
right.
but I can ask it to a senior. If I'm a sophomore taking a test, I can ask you that question to a senior. That senior can actually use their cell phone to actually search for the answer and text it back to me.
Right. It's like they have a lifeline.
Yeah.
From that old game show, Who Wants to Be a Millionaire?
Yes.
It's like, I'd like to use a lifeline. You know, and you're so right. We don't think in those terms because when we went to school, that was not a possibility.
No.
You couldn't just sit at your desk and Google someone or text something mm-hmm. to someone. But what I notice too is when my girls are doing homework, all of their friends, they're asking, well, what did you do for this page?
Right.
And they're taking pictures of their homework and sending it to each other.
Mm-hmm.
And I know that they don't think that's cheating.
Mm-hmm.
They just think it's sharing information. So
mm-hmm.
where is the line and how do you
control
that line?
But it's interesting though, because part of it is actually, okay, when we ask it, where are we drawing the line, whether we're sharing information or whether we're actually cheating?
Mm-hmm.
You know, if you're taking a test and you're supposed to actually know the answer by yourself without any help, and all of a sudden you actually get that answer from somebody else via your cell phone,
mm-hmm.
Via a text or a picture, well, that's cheating, because
mm-hmm.
you're not actually coming up with the answer, you know, by yourself. But if you're actually having a group discussion, if you're actually doing homework, because now you can do homework without a group homework without necessarily being with your friends.
Oh,
your friends can be somewhere else.
And that's what they do.
Yeah.
I mean, that is what they do. Both of my girls, it'll be like, well, you know, I can't put my phone away yet because I need to talk to so-and-so about social stuff. And they will have a group chat going about, what did you think of this assignment?
And that's a great way of using technology.
Okay.
It's a great way to sort of actually sharing information.
Stand down.
Yeah. It's a great way for them to communicate because they're helping each other.
Right.
Now, if they're taking a test based on the homework
mm-hmm.
that they did, they're supposed to do the answers without necessarily actually asking for help.
But do you think we're being clear enough with them as to what the definition of cheating is. Do you think that they understand? I mean, clearly if they're texting someone for the answer, they get that they're... But if what if they have access to Google? Or, or are schools controlling this?
Well, it's interesting because actually you have now schools banning cell phones from the classrooms, right? And so, and one of the reasons why they do that is for this particular... you know, problem, cheating. And so, you know, they're not allowed to use their cell phone during the classroom. Even for the most part, though, even it's banned, how do you know actually the kid doesn't have their cell phone in their pockets?
Totally. I feel so badly for these teachers.
You know, and then you have a teacher who are actually administering a test, and he or she might have 30 or 20 students in the classroom, and trying to watch all of them at the same time is hard. But there's technology actually now available even for them to use. And so there is there's something actually is called a pocket hound cell phone. And basically what it does is a piece of equipment that they actually wear, and it sort of actually can get the signal of any cell phone that is in the classroom. And so that's a way for them to know
somebody's got a phone.
And then you will actually take it away while they're taking a test. And so think about this. We're using technology to sort of combat the negative things that we do with technology.
Right.
And for the most part, kids might not be aware that actually if they have a question and they go into Google using their smartphone, they might not be aware that it's actually that cheating, because they're used to do that even when they're doing homework. Mm-hmm. They actually do research.
That's what I'm saying. Like, they are growing up in a different reality than we are.
And having a conversation in regards to that, so they understand the difference, I think it's actually, it's very convenient. Is very positive, not only for them, but even for us as parents, because we're not used to think that way, because we never grew up with that type of technology when we're going to school. And so having that sort of that difference and making that difference very clear with kids, I think is very important.
And a worthwhile conversation that, to be honest, I never have had yet with my kids, but I will now. Hey, technology genius, how do I get this right?
There you go.
Okay. Uh-huh. I want to take some questions from people that are joining us on our chat. Ann Swanberg says, yes, I work in a college. We have caught students using apps, et cetera, to cheat on exams, I'm sure. And I guess, you know, we expect them to really use their laptops all the time. For my kids, I used to always think, well, there'll be a certain time and all the technology gets put away.
Mm-hmm.
But it's really not realistic anymore, because they absolutely do need their laptops to do their homework.
Mm-hmm.
But can you enlighten parents as to what they can do on their laptop? Because sometimes you think, well, if I take their phone...
Mm-hmm.
And they're only doing homework on their laptop.
Yeah. Well, and think about it. I mean, the laptop, they have access to pretty much anything. So the apps that you might have in your smartphone, you can also have in your laptops as well. So the only thing that you've done is change one device with another.
Mm-hmm.
That's pretty much it. You can text using a laptop. You can actually do video calls using a laptop. You can have a video chat using a laptop.
Mm-hmm.
Pretty much what you can do with the smartphone, you can do with a laptop now. And so I think what's important, though, is for parents to sort of actually be aware of what's going on and how technology is being used by the kids. Now, it's so hard for us to sort of actually try to keep up with all the new apps that are coming up. We might be talking about some apps here tonight. In the next 3 or 4 or 5 months, new ones are going to be coming up as well. And so, but I think having that conversation with your kid is very important. Here, why? I think, and probably you have talked about this, but for the most part, teens are not thinking about the consequences of using technology, right? They're thinking in the moment. They don't necessarily think long term. And for us parents, we got to do the thinking for them when we actually having this type of conversation. Because anything that you actually post online is there forever.
Mm-hmm.
You have no idea how it's going to be used. And so even for those apps, when you have messages and pictures that they disappear, once somebody see it, you have no guarantee that picture of that message, it's in some server, you know, across the world. And so, and I think that's important for you to be aware of, and for teens to be aware of. And so basically, so how do we control that? Can we use technology as parents to actually keep control of that? Definitely. There are many apps that we can actually use in which we can monitor and control the access to technology.
Mm-hmm.
But not without having a good conversation with your kid. Tell them what you're doing and tell them why you're doing it, because they're not thinking that way.
Well, and I love that you said that, because that is probably the number one question that we get during this chat, and the same thing with last night is people saying, how do I monitor my child without them knowing?
Mm-hmm.
Or how do I monitor what they're doing without having to actually physically have their phone?
Mm-hmm.
So I know we've got Karen and Kathy and Tricia, yep. all of them kind of asking that same sure. question. And I know that there are apps you can use, and I would love for you to name them, mm-hmm. the ones you think are the best yep. apps. But also, I love that you said have the conversation first. Mm-hmm. Don't just try to put a ghost app mm-hmm. on and secretly watch. Let them know they're right. being watched.
Yeah. And I think this is an opportunity, I think, for parents to have a conversation with their kids. Because otherwise, if we just tell them, you're not allowed to do this, I'm going to be watching you, and we sort of actually are talking at them mm-hmm. rather than actually having a conversation, we are missing a huge opportunity. And so I think having a conversation, making them understand why is it that you're doing what you're doing is important. Now, it doesn't mean that they're going to agree with you. Mm-hmm. And you have to be prepared that they might not see the same way that you're seeing it. But at the end of the day, you still want to have the conversation because it takes several conversations sometimes for them to get
mm-hmm.
your point. Mm-hmm. And so, and I think that's very important. I mean, there are actually apps that they can use for them to start learning how to use social media properly. Because for the most part, they don't care. They just grab a picture, right? Mm-hmm. Whatever they're doing, they're at a party, whatever, and they post it. They're not thinking pretty much in what, you know, somebody else can grab the picture. Somebody actually, if I'm applying for a job, they can look me up. They can find those pictures. They're not thinking that way. They're mm-hmm. thinking in the moment. Mm-hmm. And so we have to sort of actually have that conversation. What happens if somebody actually finds this picture, you're trying to look for a job, and you actually get rejected because of the content that you actually have produced? It's pretty much, if you think about it, the way that I see it too, you're sort of actually creating your own brand as a kid.
Right.
Pretty much that's what you do.
It's your personal brand.
It's your personal brand.
What about if they think, because I know Instagram, for example, my kids have a Finsta account, which is kind of their fake Instagram.
Yep.
And kids use that sometimes to post the drinking pictures or mm-hmm. drug pictures. Mm-hmm. Or they might think, well, it's safe because it's Finsta, and my mm-hmm. future employer's not going to have any idea
right.
what my name is, and they're not going to be able to find this mm-hmm. because my mom can't even find
right.
it. Are they safe there?
Well, no. But we go back to the point that it's in an app. It's out there in the internet.
Mm-hmm.
And so, and for the audience that actually, you know, trying to, figure out what Finsta is, basically it's a fake Instagram account.
Mm-hmm.
And what you do, basically, you have a narrow circle of friends there in which you want to share more personal pictures.
Mm-hmm.
Think about this. Instagram is an app in which you are taking pictures. You have filters, so you're making pretty. You
mm-hmm.
put some text. You want to look good. Right?
Mm-hmm.
And so, and that, your profile might be accessible to, hundreds of thousands of people.
Grandma can follow you on Instagram.
Exactly. And that's not a problem at all. But then Finsta, then you create another account, and that account is only, you're only allowed to sort of give access to, the friends that you choose to. So you can have, instead of actually having hundreds of thousands of followers, you have in your public account, in your Finsta account, you only have 10, 15, 20, 30, mm-hmm. 40. So it's a very narrowed down group of people. With those people, you choose to, you can share pictures and videos without mm-hmm. any filters,
mm-hmm.
doing silly things. And for
right.
the most part, that's what you want
to
do.
And you don't have to look beautiful, because for a long time, there are all these rules around
no.
Instagram. You only post on Instagram
yeah.
once a week.
Right.
And now with Finsta, it's kind of
yeah.
sillier, but sometimes a little more dangerous.
Right. And so you have to sort of actually know exactly who those friends are, because
mm-hmm.
you don't know is actually one of those, one of those friends actually might grab your picture or video and post it somewhere else.
Mm-hmm.
So that's the piece that you don't have control over. And here's one thing that I always tell parents and teenagers, you have control of what you post, you have control of the video that you upload, the pictures that you
mm-hmm.
upload, but you have no control of what people are going to do with them. No matter how well you know them, you lose control totally once those pictures are out there.
Mm-hmm. I know, and emotions run high as teenagers too.
Yeah.
And so one day it's your best friend or your boyfriend, and the next day, maybe not so much. We have that conversation
yeah.
too. A lot of people are wondering, why don't teachers just take away cell phones? And I know that there are schools where they don't.
Yeah.
Where they've just made a decision that this is not a fight we're picking, and
mm-hmm.
we'll have rules around cell phones.
Mm-hmm.
And I have one daughter I can reach very easily during
mm-hmm.
the school day,
yep.
and one daughter that's very hard to get a hold of.
Mm-hmm.
And even if they don't take away cell phones, you can still text on your laptop and do
yeah.
all those things, as we were saying.
Yeah.
So, but I have heard of schools that have kind of they shut down the Wi-Fi.
Mm-hmm.
What direction do you think this is going in?
Well, the thing is, actually, you have some school districts that are very, they're very protective, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so they're very strict in how that you're going to be using your devices. And so the Wi-Fi is very limited. If you actually access the school network, you only are allowed to access certain websites
mm-hmm.
or certain apps
mm-hmm.
that have to do with, schoolwork. Even if you don't actually have access to the Wi-Fi of the school, if you want to use your data plan, it's the signal is so weak that you pretty much cannot do anything.
See, and I like that idea.
Yeah.
Is there a downside to that?
Well, really, there's no downside to it. I mean, I think if you think about it, if the school goal is to sort of minimize the cheating, for example, you know, that's one way of doing it.
Right.
On the other hand, I understand from the parents' perspective that they want to be able to reach their kids, you know, regardless any time of the day. But you can do that via laptops. You can certainly text them, mm-hmm. and they can actually get text. One of the things that you can actually do sometimes, even the signal might be weak, you're still able to receive text, mm-hmm. so that's fine. But it depends on the goal of the schools. Now, there are schools that sort of actually say, okay, we have certain rules in how you can use technology. We're not gonna go after you if we see you with your cell phone in the classroom. And that's fine, because that's a fight that they have decided not to have.
And I'm sure it's a constant fight.
Yeah, it is a constant fight. But on the other hand, then the question is, okay, so how do you deal with cheating? Well, for some of the schools, might be that it's not a matter of cheating, but they want to be able to say, okay, let's have you use technology in a way that will allow you to get to the answer that you want to get if you're actually taking a test. Mm-hmm. It's not so much now, because we know that you can write yourself on your smart device and you can look up the answer and, mm-hmm. and get it. So the cheating piece of it, that's not what the school is after. So mm-hmm. that's not a priority for them, because the test is not being given, and so they know that the student actually know the answer themselves, but they want to actually do it in a way that the student know how to use technology to find the answer.
Right.
And so it depends on the school district goals. They have different rules and different guidelines on how you can use cell phones. And I think it goes back to the parents' piece. The conversation that you're having with your kid, how you're using technology once you're in school and after school is over.
So let's say you've had the conversation,
mm-hmm.
and you're talking about what values your family has around tone, pictures, all those kind of things. And then you're saying, and we are going to install this app so that we can monitor how much time you're spending and what mm-hmm. you're doing when you're online. What apps do you recommend that are safe for the mm-hmm. parents to use? Because I always worry when I'm downloading something
yeah.
that then who's collecting that data,
mm-hmm.
and who are you sharing all that information with, whoever's
sure.
gathering it. And also, you know, are these apps free? Are there some that are better than others? If you
right.
pay more, it's a better app? What
sure.
would you recommend?
I mean, with anything that is free, you have limited resources and limited features.
Mm-hmm.
I think if you want to be able to have control, if you want to be able to monitor the activity of your kids in social media or by using their smartphones, you most likely will have to invest. But the amount of money that you have to invest is not a lot. For example, mm-hmm. one of the apps that I recommend is called Custodio. So it's Q-U-S-T-O-D-I-O.
Q-U-S-T-O. Oh, kind of like Custodio.
Yeah,
but with
Custodio.
Okay.
And so basically that app allows you pretty much to track everything. You can track phone calls, you can track text messages, you can track pictures, videos. You can decide which app they're allowed to download and use.
Mm-hmm.
You limit the time that they can use their cell phone. I think you pay, I believe it's about $49.95, and you can actually protect up to 5 devices. It's $49.95 for a full year.
Okay.
They have a free trial. So if you're not sure that's the app that you want, you can download it on your kid's smartphone. You can get one account for free, and you start playing with it. You start getting
mm-hmm.
familiar with it. And that solves the problem. You can download it, to the rest of the other devices.
So let's break that down a little bit.
Sure.
You said you could put 5 devices on it, so you could put laptop, cell phones,
yep.
that kind of thing on it.
Yep.
And then it's a ghost on their phone. So it's best to talk to your child about it, but it's not like it's going to show up as an icon on their
phone.
No,
they will be able to see it. It's there. It's there.
Oh, they will see it too on their
phone. Yeah, it's
okay.
there, because you have to grab their cell phone. You will download it. You will download the app. And here's the thing why I'm sort of more in favor of telling your kid what you're doing.
Mm-hmm.
It's because pretty much now what they will do is pretty much try to watch how they actually portray themselves online.
Right.
Because for the most part, when you're online, you're a different person than
mm-hmm.
what,
mm-hmm.
you know, when you're offline.
Right, especially as teenagers. I think it's so hard for them to understand tone sometimes.
Yep.
And thinking about, would you say that to someone's face?
Right.
So why would you say it online if
yep.
you're not going to say it? So all of that, it's a good thing you told them you're watching ahead of time, so when you want to intervene and say,
yeah.
I noticed this conversation was going a little. So.
Right, and they're going to know, because when you intervene, they're going to say, well, how do you find out? Remember,
yeah.
we
yeah.
downloaded an app.
Right.
And so.
And they forget quickly.
And they do.
Because I am one that monitors, and my kids roll their eyes, but I monitor pretty closely, and
mm-hmm.
And they forget.
Yeah.
They get so caught up in their own world. So
yeah.
It's not like now they're not going to be their real selves online, right?
Yeah. Well, yeah. And I think, you know, one of the things is for them to start understanding, though. I mean, just because you're online, it doesn't mean that you pretty much can do anything that you want to. I mean, think about this. For the most part, we tell our kids, okay, don't talk back. Be respectful. When you're outside, you know, say hello, good morning, thank you, please. It's the same thing when you're online. And so we're not asking you to do something different. You just sort of actually, you know, got to grab those values, transmit those values, and put in practice online. Mm-hmm. But for the most part, kids don't do it because they believe they're protected by that screen, by that smartphone, by their social media profile, and they pretty much can be and do anything that they want to. And so they're totally person. Now, for the parent, for the most part, they're like, whoa, I had no idea you were acting this way because I can see you around with other kids, and you're so well-behaved and respectful.
Right. It is a whole other world.
It is a whole other world.
So ask questions, guys. We're going to be wrapping this up soon. So if you have questions for Carlos, he's got a lot of information. Mm-hmm. And I'm monitoring what people are asking here and just making comments, mostly in agreement with what you're saying. I think a lot of people, too, wonder, in this day and age when kids are getting access to these mini computers, mm-hmm. these cell phones, mm-hmm. early and earlier, do you have a recommended age that you say, you know, they're probably mature enough or this is a good mm-hmm. age to give them a phone? Because they start begging at a very early age. Has your 9-year-old asked yet?
Well, my 6-year-old asked for a cell phone. And so, you know, and so they...
She just wants to be connected with what you're doing at work.
Right, you know? Right. And so, you know, my son, for example, you know, he's 6, my daughter, she's 9. They both want smartphones just because they saw a friend of theirs at school that, you know, they have a smartphone.
Yeah, yeah.
But what they don't understand, though, that they might have a cell phone, but they don't understand that the cell phone is very limited in how they can use. Because now you can actually buy cell phones, and you can limit, you can only text, and you can only dial, you know, 1 or 2 numbers. Mm-hmm. Of course, we're talking a younger age.
Right.
And so when you ask me then, what's the minimum age for a kid to actually have a smartphone or have some sort of these devices? It's up to the family. Mm-hmm. Because, I mean, I know families that they have 5, 6 years old, they don't allow them to use tablets. They use tablets at school, mm-hmm. but at home, they don't allow them to use tablets. And so, you know, I've had conversations with my kids since my son was 5 years old in how to use technology properly. Mm-hmm. If you're talking about social media sites, for the most part, a lot of those social networking sites, you have to be 13 years old in order for you to create your own profile. Mm-hmm. Can you create a fake profile and you put a different age? There are social networking sites in which, yes, you can. So if you notice then, the point goes back to always, how do I talk to my kid? Because it doesn't matter how much we protect them. It doesn't matter how much we try to block from them, to use any sort of device. At the end of the day, we have to have the conversation because we're not with them 24/7.
And you do have to have it a lot. And even if you're looking on their phone and you're seeing that they're on Snapchat or they're on Instagram, to understand that there are divisions within those apps.
Mm-hmm.
There's the Finsta on Instagram, and there's the For Your Eyes Only
mm-hmm.
on Snapchat segment.
Yeah.
Is there a place or a blog or somewhere that parents can go kind of on a consistent basis to keep up with what these apps are? Is there a place you would recommend?
Common Sense Media. It's a nonprofit organization. I follow them and I read a lot about their blog posts. They actually write a lot of good articles in how to use social media for teens.
And what's going on with teens.
Right. So commonsensemedia.org is a great website that I would recommend for them to actually go and check out.
And I just have to ask you this on a personal level because my girls in the last few months had downloaded House Party.
Mm-hmm.
Can you tell us what House Party is?
And, I'm not familiar with House Party.
Okay. My understanding is a lot of people can kind of Skype at the same time.
Okay.
But this is what I'm saying. It changes so fast.
Mm-hmm.
One day it was all about Instagram. Then all of a sudden it was all about Snapchat. And now all of a sudden there are multiple people that can talk on FaceTime at the same time on House Party.
Okay.
I have a very rudimentary understanding.
Uh-huh.
And my reaction, I guess, as a parent is always fear. And so I'm thinking, oh, no, what's that?
Mm-hmm.
And a little education goes a long way to help us kind of take a deep breath, right?
You know, and here's the interesting about it. For the most part, if we don't know about something and we're afraid of something, we sometimes say, okay, I don't want you to use that app. Here's what I would suggest that you would do as parents. If you don't know what an app does, download it yourself. Play around with it. Mm-hmm. Get familiar with all the features. Because for the most part, a lot of these apps are not necessarily used for negative things.
Right.
They're used for communication. They're used to, you know, they're teenagers. They want to, you know, post pictures of themselves. They want to talk to each other. And that's great. I think the downside is when we start thinking about okay, what else can we do? You know, if I don't like somebody's school, can I use this for bully? Mm-hmm. And so that's the piece that we want to be careful. We're going to have conversations about. But for the most part, technology can be used to actually have, you know, a fun way of you communicating with each other. That's how teens are communicating with each other nowadays.
I know, and I did try to Snapchat with my girls, and one of them blocked me, and the other one will talk to me, but it's a great connection to have them try to teach you, too.
Yeah.
You know, well, tell me about this hairspray. Yeah. Let me see how it works. Mm-hmm. And try to get over that hump where they're resistant to that. All right, so we've got the Custodio, is that how you say it?
Yep.
CommonSense.org.
Yep.
And time for one last question, which is there another app or another blog or something you would recommend to parents?
Well, there's actually another app. It's called TeenSafe.
Okay.
TeenSafe.org. It's the name of the app, but also they actually have very good articles in how to use social media, articles for parents. You know, if you're looking for ways to, okay, what else can I learn about Snapchat and how Snapchat is being used for, you know, by my teens, TeenSafe.org. It's a great site that I would recommend for them,
I've
too.
I've never heard of that
yeah.
one. I appreciate that.
Yeah,
we'll be
TeenSafe.org. Yeah.
Carlos, we so appreciate your insight and
Thank
your
you.
Time tonight. Thank you so much for
Thank
coming
you.
In.
My
Great
pleasure.
To meet you.
Thank you. Likewise.